to and agree to the terms you will give me. Right? Got it?
The whole thing. The whole thing. Okay. You can skip all the heights at the end. Josh would be helpful.
After this, the word of the Lord came to Abram in a vision. Do not be afraid, Abram.
I am your shield, your very great reward. But Abram said, O sovereign Lord, what can you give me since I remain childless? And the one who will inherit my estate is Eliezer of Damascus. And Abram said, you have given me no children, so a servant in my household will be my heir. Then the word of the Lord came to him. This man will not be your heir, but a son coming from your own body will be your heir. He took him outside and said, look up at the heavens and count the stars, if indeed you can count them. Then he said to him, so shall your offspring be. Abram believed the Lord, and he credited to him his righteousness. He also said to him, I am the Lord who brought you out of Ur of the Chaldeans to give you this land to take possession of. But Abram said, O sovereign Lord, how can I know that I will gain possession of you? So the Lord said to him, bring me a heifer, a goat, and a ram, each 3 years old, along with a dove and a young pigeon. Abram brought all these to him, cut them in two, and arranged the halves opposite each other. The birds, however, he did not cut in half. Then the birds of prey came down on the carcasses, but Abram drove them away. As the sun was setting, Abram fell into a deep sleep, and a thick and dreadful darkness came over him. Then the Lord said to him, know for certain that all your descendants will be strangers in a country. Wow. And they will be enslaved and mistreated 400 years. But I will punish the nation they serve as slaves, and afterward they will come out with great possessions. You, however, will go to your fathers in peace and be buried at a good old age. In the fourth generation, your descendants will come back here, for the sin of the Amorites has not yet reached its full measure. Then the sun had set, and darkness had fallen. A smoking fire pot with a blazing torch appeared and passed between the pieces. On that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abram and said, to your descendants I will give this land. From the river of Egypt to the Great Sea to all the lights.
Okay, so basically anyone with the last name Eit is a Canaanite, except for Israelites. Okay, so all the Eits that go on there. We'll explain that in a minute. But this is God giving the land. This is the end of it. It's already continued happening all the way up to here. We'll come back to that later on this week. But this is the covenant. Remember, I said it's a land and a people covenant. They have to go hand in hand. You can't have one without the other. All right? Now I'm going to use... I threw some big stones over here. I'm going to use some stones just to kind of illustrate.
Let's say these are the pieces of the animals. Remember, they're very specific. They were cut in half, placed down. Basically, what I'm trying to get at is it's a big bloody mess all around here. And what happens is if I'm, let's say, the king of Egypt or the king of Babylon, and I defeat you in front of your nation and in front of my nation, or your generals and my generals and witnesses, we both step foot in the middle of this bloody mess, okay? So we're both standing in here, and we swear, because I won, gods of Egypt are stronger, on the name of the gods of Egypt, from here on out, I get to dictate the terms because I'm the victor. Your people will give us 300 women. We'll give you 400 horses, you'll give me 50 pieces of gold, I'll give you trade routes and whatever. I get to dictate whatever I want. Your people are your witness, my people are my witness. If you don't stand up to your part of the covenant, this will be your and your people's destiny. If I don't stand up to my part of the covenant, this will be my people, me and my people's destiny, okay? This is a covenant called the covenant of the pieces because you're cutting all these animals in pieces. Only kings can make this covenant, okay? Now, what happens here is very, very important because remember, both kings are standing in this mess. It has to be a blood covenant. By the way, in the ancient world, in order to make a covenant, something has to die or something has to be cut. There must be blood. Why does Messiah have to be crucified? There must be blood. Blood has to pay for it, okay? Children of Israel, first thing we do when we enter the land,
were circumcised. It's the sign of the covenant. There has to be a cut. Okay? Actually, in Hebrew, when you say to make a covenant, you say to cut a covenant. Because there has to be cutting. God cuts into the stone with his finger. Right? So this action of cutting is very necessary. We won't get into that, though. And you can see the warning that God is giving Abraham. Your people, they're going to be in this land. Now, before you take the land, they're going to go into slavery for 400 years. But I will bring my punishment on that nation, and they will come out with all their riches and all their gold and all the blah, 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 blah. And they do. And they come back and they enter the children of Israel into this land. But before that, I want to show you something very important here. When we talked about replacement theology, because it affected my life, and you shared with your story, the same thing in many other Jews, especially in the Christian world, have the same story. We've been told that we're insignificant to God. God's replaced us. Islam says the same thing. We're the people of the book. We've been replaced. Everyone is replaced in the Jewish people. What's the point of being Jewish? Why do we keep our traditions alive? Well, here's why. So it says, when the sun was setting, Abram fell into a deep sleep. There's Abram off in the side. He just prepared this gory mess here. And now, a thick and dreadful darkness came over him. Then the Lord said to him, verse 17. When the sun had set, he's still asleep over there. When the sun had set and darkness had fallen, a smoking fire pot, as portrayed by Benny. Smoking fire pot with a blazing torch appeared and passed between the pieces. I am now in the pieces. This is the beginning of the act of this covenant. On that day, the Lord made a covenant with Abraham and said, To your descendants, I give this land from the river of Egypt to the great river, the Euphrates, the land of on and on and on, all the ites. But notice, Abraham's not in this gory mess. Only God is standing here. Remember, the first thing we do is we swear on the highest name known to man. Oh yeah, that's me. God is saying, on my name, on my reputation, I will give this land to you and your descendants for all eternity. This is God saying this. He's the one now bound by this covenant. Abraham's not bound to this covenant, guys. He's not even in the body mess. He's asleep. Night. Okay? So God is saying, I am making this covenant on my name's sake. Meaning, Israel, Abraham, and his descendants can walk away at any moment. The prodigal son can be gone. But when we decide to return, guess who's there waiting for us? Because he has to. God will always welcome his people back because it is his covenant with the people. But we're not bound to the same thing. Technically, if I was in here and I broke covenant, it's my death. Right? That's the end of the covenant. I'm dead. Now, the important part to this is part of this covenant is me, once again I'm Egypt, when my father dies, I'm the new king of Egypt. I call you the new king of Babylon, and we step in the same gory mess here, and I can dictate new terms to you. My dad said 500 gold pieces, 200 gold pieces, I want 1,000 gold pieces. I will give you 600 horses, I will give you this and this. I can add new terms to the deal. But I can never take away from the deal that I was already there. Why? It's not my deal to make. I can add because I'm still the ruling king, but I never defeated you in battle. So if you don't agree, well, you're still bound to this, but I can't take away from what your father agreed to. Meaning, you can always add on to the covenant, but you can never take away. So if we have a covenant with Israel at Sinai, you can't take that away. It's not yours to take away. Right? God swore in his name, and the God I serve is the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. Right? He swore in the highest name known to anybody, on his own name. My God cannot take away anything. So if he said this land belongs to Israel, well, who does it belong to? Israel. Because he said so. Just because people come around and try to say, nope, that's the old covenant, we're in a new covenant. Well, the type of covenant that he's making here is irreversible. You can add on to it, and Yeshua is a... Yesterday I said I don't like old covenants. I say the older covenant and the renewed covenant. Because that's what this is. Yeshua is renewing the very same covenant. But when you do this, something has to be cut, right? It has to be blood. Well, it's his blood this time. And that's the ultimate sacrifice. We don't need anything else after that. But it's the exact same covenant he's renewing. He's adding a little bit more on, but he can never take away what his father said. I think it's very important, pivotal actually, to understand this, because if you don't get this, Joshua.
There's a lot of people out there teaching about replacement theology. A lot of people that come in contact with Jews say, you've been replaced, you're insignificant. That does a lot to a person to tell them you're not important anymore. You know, I've held on to my Jewish identity for 2,000 years, and suddenly, whoops, what was it for? For nothing. I'm irrelevant to God's plan. Okay, I'll become Christian. That's the new Jewish, right? We're all Christians now. But it's not. God kept these people, brought them back to this land, insignificant people, insignificant patch of land, for the redemption of the world. That's why he does this. And there's a very pivotal part of this sentence that we'll read some other time because it's a long conversation in chapter 13 that shows us this glimpse. And once again, everybody reading it, at least through a Jewish perspective, knows, because we have these hyperlinks, we have the language, and we know the land. That's why you have to know the land in order to understand the language that God is speaking in, because he's speaking directly to a people. His people, Jew or Gentile, it doesn't matter. Because if you're attached to the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, you've been to Jerusalem, you've been to this land, you know the word that God gave us, the Bible, because this is who you worship. But if you're new into it and you haven't studied with the people that know, well, you can come up with your own theories then. It doesn't make them right. So I think it's very important to understand Genesis chapter 15, because it is a covenant that is irrevocable. And then we continue on to Romans chapter 11, and you can see what covenant you're being grafted into. It's Abraham's covenant, okay? I'm lucky enough to be part of his descendants. You guys, through the finished works of Messiah, are lucky enough to enter through what he's done. The covenant was always intended for everybody, okay? But God's got to start somewhere. He gives it to the Jewish people, and we see ourselves as the keeper of God's word. Which is why we're so strict about God's word, and why we've evolved into what Judaism is today, as trying to retain that tradition that we have. But it's through what we understand in Romans 11, we can do that another time, that you enter into this covenant, not replacing, but joining in.
Amen.
Okay? And then I was going to talk about the fig tree, but we don't have enough time. We can do that on the bus. Okay? So that being said, let's go eat.